Hey Internet. So today we're going to do another boa constrictor video. So we talked a little bit about genetics and stuff like that in another video that we did previously. But someone was asking me exactly what's the difference between like the real constrictors, the true red tails and imperators and Central Americans and stuff like that. And so I thought, okay, it gets a little bit complicated, so we'll just do a video about it. And so we're going to start this video off doing a little bit of background. So boa constrictors. So that means they're a boa'd species. So they're constricting snakes, and there are a wide variety of different ones. And I think he's cruising. I don't know where he's going. And, you know, there's a lot of different boas out there. So there's boa constrictors, there's rosy boas, anacondas, rubber boas. But this video, we're only going to be talking about boa constrictors. And so when we talk about that, that's the actual species boa constrictor. So that's even the Latin name for them too, is boa constrictor. And from that point is when it starts to get a little bit more complicated. So in the species boa constrictor, yep, there he goes. In the species boa constrictor, there are quite a few subspecies. This is going to be, hopefully I'm going to keep this as easy to digest as possible. So when we talk about the subspecies in the hobby, we're mostly talking about two different subspecies, and that is the boa imperator and the boa constrictor, or the boa constrictor. So when we say common boa or Colombian boa or red-tailed boa, almost all of those are referring to the boa imperator. So that is a subspecies that is found from northern South America, like the west side of Peru and like west of the Andes, up into Central America, up into lower Mexico. That's where a lot of the boa morphs came from. So a lot of the aneries, the hypos, the different patterns, and a lot of the albinos all came from the imperator. And those got bred into some of the other localities and other subspecies as well. So while we're on the subject of the boa imperator, who this is our visual representation of that, he's just going to be climbing all over the place. There is a little bit of confusion when they say a CA or Central American boa. So what that is a specific region or locality of the imperator subspecies. So when I said that they were found all the way from northern South America all the way up into Mexico, there's a wide variety of habitats and localities and color patterns of the entire subspecies imperator in that. And they have found that specific localities, the further north you go up into lower Mexico and Central America, are a little bit more physically different, more than just the color pattern, than some of like the South American imperators. They're usually a little bit smaller. Their head shape is a little bit different. They're usually darker in color. And whether or not it's necessarily deserved, they usually come with a little bit more of a cantankerous attitude. In the hobby, when we say a CA or Central American boa, hey buddy, that is in reference to a Central American region or specific bloodlines or localities of the boa imperator. So like Hog Island boas, those are imperators. A lot of the other boas, like the blood boas and the leopard boas, all of those came from the CA locality of the boa imperator. Now, that being said, so if you're breeding like a albino imperator to a leopard or to like a Tarahuma mountain, that is technically not crossing species, but then you're crossing different localities. And that's where some of the kind of like snobbery comes in, where people only specifically breed locality-specific things, species-specific things, and certain bloodlines. And I don't want to get too much into that, but that's where a lot of like kind of like the boa snobbery comes from, is people who are just trying to produce something interesting or different or trying to see what they make, versus people who are doing very, very specific, I only breed Tarahuma Mountain, I only breed Hog Island, I only breed this one specific region of whatever boa imperator. So we're going to put this guy away, and then we're going to bring up the next subspecies that's also one of the most common species in the hobby. Okay, here's Severus. She's been out a couple different times, and she's probably going to climb. For a snake that we got that was super overweight and really chunky, she really likes to climb. But Sev here is a boa constrictor, or a true red-tailed boa. So this is the part where people kind of get a little bit up in arms about. So when we talked about the Imperators before with the guy that we had out before, that when they say a red tail, Colombian, or common boa, that's the Imperator. These guys are the boa constrictor, or what I refer to as the true red tails. And what that is in reference to is, if I can get her tail over here, is you can see her tail, like they can get much more vibrant depending on the locality. But that is a really, really red, red tail, and that's where they get their name red tail boa from. The constrictors, like I said, they're the true red tails. They are found exclusively in South America. They come in a lot of different localities because South America is a really big region. And they come in, they're found in a lot of different countries and a lot of different environments. She's going to go. She loves to go high. She's such a climber. This Sev here is a Guyana boa constrictor. And so they're found in the country of Guyana. But genetically, they're exactly the same as a Suriname, the Southern Brazilians, the Bolivians, all these other boa constrictors, that they just look a little bit different, but they're all genetically the same. So when you're talking to boa people, you'll hear Guyana, and you'll hear Suriname, and you'll hear Peruvian. All of those are the same genetically, but they're all different localities, and because they're found in different regions, they look a little bit different. So like Sev here, she's still kind of brown, but she has a really like purplish red tail. She has plenty of pink on her face. When you get into Suriname, they're a little bit more silvery in color. Their saddles, they have a little bit, like you can see right here, they have what's called a widow peak, where their saddles, they're not exactly square or like a regular looking thing. They kind of come in that funky little shape. They're pretty famous and consistently have those kind of like sharp incline things, although they actually did a study a while ago where they found that like Suriname and Guyana, they don't just stop right at the country borderline. So there's a lot of crossover in those localities that occurs naturally, where essentially they were picking up Guyana boas that traditionally look like Suriname boas, and they're being found in Suriname and they look like Guyana boas and vice versa. But they're all exact, like if you believe in DNA and that's a thing, they're the same snake. Same with like the Peruvian boas. Now there's a little bit of difference, like I said, in what they look like. Like the Peruvian red tail boas, they're generally the longest examples of the subspecies. Their tails are usually the most vibrant red, but they all are still technically the true red tail boas, or the boa constrictor or boa constrictor. Hi, Sev. You know I don't like the face. Oh, right in the ear. Oh, tongue right in the ear. Ah. So we talked about the constrictor and the Imperator. Those are kind of the most common types of boas. And she's going down. Next up are some of the other subspecies that are a little bit more infrequent. And in truth, a lot of them are actually very distinctive from other boas. And those are the different subspecies. So like the Argentinian boa, the Peruvian long-tailed boa, the Bolivian short-tailed boa. And those are all distinguished by different things like scales to ventral count, to on a DNA level, they are different from the Imperators and the constrictors. So like, and those are distinguished by their own thing in the hobby when it comes to, so like the BIs, the BCs. There are now like, so for the Argentine boas, those are BCOs. So that's boa constrictor occidentalis. Or the Bolivian short tail boas, those are BCAs, the boa constrictor amarellii. Those are all very specifically different. That's actually what I am most passionate about in general. But as, you know, life goes, we didn't all get to do that, but hopefully I'll be starting to get back into some of those soon. Here, what we have with me here, this is Blue. She is very special. Number one, because she has a bit of a neurological issue, and it's not because she was improperly bred, it's because she got really hot. We're not 100% sure if it was from the person, and she's going! If we're not sure if it's from the person that we got her from. Okay, we're back. So, as I was saying, Blue is very special because she has a bit of a neurological issue. And it's not because she's improperly bred or has like a genetic thing like spider ball pythons or jaguar carpet pythons. It's because she got really hot. That's something that can happen. It's essentially you're cooking. the animal if it gets, like, if you have temperatures over 100 degrees when it comes to a lot of snake species. And we're pretty sure it happened while she was in transit because we got her over the summer. It was kind of hot. But I digress. She's still perfectly fine. She's very healthy. She eats fine. She's a boa. She has a great food response. She's just a little bit wonky. But Blue is also very special because she is actually a hybrid. We purchased her before we really knew a whole lot about the different things. I knew about a couple different things, and she looked really, really pretty, and I went, I want her. She is a cross between a BCO and a BCA, so an Argentinian boa and a Bolivian silverback short-tail boa. So the Argentine boas, or the BCOs, those are those very distinctive, very dark animals, almost black. They're very, very dark with very kind of small, defined, silver, light yellow markings. And there are different bloodlines that affect that, that can change it up a little bit. And then there's the Bolivian silverback ones, which are usually a little bit smaller versus the Argentine boas, which are very large, a little bit more heavy body. They're more terrestrial than like the Colombian boas. They're a little bit, the silverbacks are a little bit shorter. They're called silverbacks because they are bright, bright gunmetal gray silver. And they usually have very distinctive, very thin saddles. So if you look at Blue, all right, well, give me just a second. But so what that means is that someone in, you know, specifically did cross them to try to get an interesting looking snake. And they certainly did achieve that. But it's kind of frowned upon doing hybrids and stuff in a lot of different circles. We won't be breeding her, but we're going to keep her for the rest of her life. But so here we go. We have her back. You can kind of see. So Argentinian boas, you can, like, if you look at her head, that is very similar to the markings that an Argentinian, but well, she'll stay still, that an Argentine boa has, only it's a little bit reversed. They're usually very dark black, and then it's lighter markings that have that kind of head pattern. Hers is the silver because she gets that from the Amarellia or the short or the silverback boa. And then her saddles are also inherited kind of from the silverback, but they're a little bit thicker than you normally see because of the Argentine. And then she's that very, very dark coloration from the Argentinian boa. So I really liked Argentines. They're my favorite. In fact, there is a specific bloodline called the Max Pink line that a guy down in Florida has been selectively breeding for the past like 20 years, which if anybody has some available, hit me up. But she's a cool, cool little girl. And we love her to death, but like I said before, we're probably not going to be breeding her at all. She's just a fun little, very pretty snake, and we love, 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 love Blue. So there are quite a few other subspecies of boas other than the ones we talked about. There are a lot that we don't even have in the United States, like the boa constrictor nebulosa, which are Dominican boa constrictors. Those things are absolutely gorgeous, but we don't have them here in the States. We have one more subspecies here at Jay-Z's Reptiles, and that's the boa constrictor longicata, or the Peruvian longtail boa. We're just now getting back into them, and she has one of our foundation animals. She's currently in quarantine and in Blue right now, so we're not going to bring her out. But they're pretty distinctive. They stay a lot smaller than these guys. Like, even the imperators, they very commonly get over 6 feet long. Longicatas, they usually, like, big females cap out at around 6 feet. We don't have her out. We just have our double het boa imperator out again just because, yeah, it's nice to have a camera, an animal on camera every now and again. But so hopefully that cleared up a little bit about that. I know it's somewhat complicated and there's a lot of different things, and it's hard to digest when you hear subspecies and species and all the different localities and things like that. But that's hopefully that kind of sums it up a little bit. So, you know, the CA boas, those are imperators. A lot of the color patterns and morphs and stuff like that, those are imperators. The true red tails, Suris, Peruvians, Guyanas, those are the red tail boas. And the rest are usually referred to by their kind of common name or their abbreviated BCO, BCA, scientific letter abbreviations. So hopefully that did help and sum up a little. I think he's going for another sky ride again. But hopefully that did clear up some stuff up. Hope you found it informational, informative, at least a little bit interesting. I know I don't want to be over the top and crazy, but I don't want to be the guy just standing here and just yakking at you all day. And hopefully you are finding some of this information useful and helpful. Please like and subscribe if you can. Please hit that bell notification. When you do that, it does help us out. It helps the dynamics and the metrics of YouTube are kind of complicated. So if you do hit that bell and you're clicking on the links when it lights up, it really helps us out. It lets us be a little bit more visible so we can get out there. Not because I want to be famous and I want YouTube to pay me hundreds and hundreds of dollars, but just because I want a lot of people to, you know, get this information and for people to be sharing it and enjoying it and hopefully being able to put it to good use out there to better themselves, their keeping, and our hobby as a whole. If you guys have any comments or questions or anything like that, please put them down in the comments below. Hit me up on Facebook, on our Instagram with links on the channel. We post there a lot more regularly. If you're interested in some snakes, we're hopefully going to be having some ball pythons hit the ground soon. Those will probably be going in the incubator as probably in the next week or two, we're going to have the first clutches of the season being laid. Once again, thank you for, you know, subscribing. If you are guys a subscriber, thank you for giving me the time for, you know, helping me out whenever you can and just for watching the videos because it's really, really helpful and I really want to help people. I really want to get good, solid, wholesome, not derogatory information that will hopefully better everybody in the community and everyone's passions as a whole. And there go my glasses. So we're going to wrap this up because he's decided he's going to be my new head turban. Catch you guys next time. I hope you enjoyed the video and I'll see you later.